They have sold over 25 million records worldwide and scored over 13 American Top 40 hits. Singer, guitarist, bassist, Mr. Wayne Nelson of the Little River Band. Wayne, how are we doing today?
JJ, I'm doing great. We're going coast to coast here. I'm looking at the Atlantic Ocean, and you're looking at the Pacific. So we're nationwide today.
Pretty very darn cool. Close, Wayne. Pretty darn close. It's too funny. I know you grew up, Wayne, in Kansas City, but what was that musical experience like for you growing up on the outskirts of Chicago with all of that music scene going on around you?
Well, it was, philosophical. It was enriching. You could go to Lincoln Avenue, you could hear the best blues. You could go out to the suburbs and you can hear, like, the best progressive rock. I used to go watch, seriously, CTA before they were Chicago.
Wow.
For $5. Watched Styx, on the South Side kind of form and do their thing at little free college, mixers and that kind of thing. Cheap Trick was a band from Rockford, Illinois that drove down to Chicago and played. A band called The Flock, which had Jerry Goodman in it. I mean, it ran the gamut from great blues and R&B. You know, Earth, Wind, and Fire was there and left to make a statement, to go to L.A. The emotions, on and on and on. Great, great, great acts were all around the city. And when I finally kind of broke into a group of people that had recording experience, it was people from the American Breed, and they were working with Rufus. So you couldn't ask for a better learning ground than Chicago in the late 60s, early 70s to learn your craft. It was very, very cool.
And I know, Wayne, you did play in several bands there in Chicago, and you did leave to go over to right here in Los Angeles and hook up with Lagos and Messina. And how did you get spotted by the Little River Band management company? How did that all come about?
Well, I was playing with Jimmy, and in 78 he did his first solo album called Oasis. I was in, I had seen that he was looking for a bass player. He had a lot of people audition, so I don't know what the chemistry was or whatever, but I was in the right place at the right time. He auditioned over 60 L.A. bass players.
Wow.
And there was something about the chemistry that worked between us, and he felt I was a good fit for the band and what he wanted to do. That turned into the only real touring we did was Little River Band for 2 weeks on the West Coast. LRB was doing their first live record called Backstage Pass. Their bass player had quit. It was the sixth guy that they had used on bass. They wanted somebody, in addition to finding a bass player, they wanted a singing bass player. And we were all, the whole band was singing with Jimmy. So I got auditioned for 2 weeks without knowing it. And then at the end of that trip, they came and asked me to join.
And Wayne, how did they come up with the group name Little River Band? I heard it was inspired by a road sign or something like that?
Well, it was to go all the way back to the beginning, Little River Band was an assembled band. The word wasn't around yet, but in Australian terms, you would call it one of the first quote-unquote super groups in Australia. All of them had been with other successful acts. And there was a manager who was also in a successful act that decided to assemble this new group. Their business plan was big vocals, obviously good songs, and their focus was American radio. They literally weren't even interested in Australian radio up front. It was all about America. They were, so this band is assembled, they rehearse, they get a few things. Oddly enough, the first thing they were going to release was a cover of the Everly Brothers tune. Wow, it escapes me now, but Linda Ronstadt covered it just before Little River Band let it out. I've been lonely.
Oh, yeah.
When Will I Be Loved?
That's
When
it.
Will I Be Loved? Had, they had their kind of country rock version of When Will I Be Loved, and Ronstadt came out with it like weeks before they did. So, bad timing there. But anyway, they're on their way to their first gig, and they still didn't have a name. And they passed by this little town called Little River, and there's an exit sign saying Little River. And so they said, tonight, let's just be Little River Band, and we'll see how we go and if this even lasts, and the name stuck.
And Wayne, your debut album with the band, Time Exposure, came out and became home to the band's first hit single of the 1980s titled Night Owls, and which you sang lead vocals on. And what was the inspiration for that particular tune, Night Owls?
Well, a little deeper than you might think. So they auditioned this singing bass player, the American guy. I come down, I'm the new guy in the band. So we start rehearsing stuff and whatever, and all of a sudden one of the writers says, hey, I got this new song. Let's have a look at it. And I knew that was going to be the program. We were going to start working on a new CD album at the time. And the way it worked out was the band used to rehearse and break the back of the set and what we were going to do before Glenn Shorrock, who was the lead singer, before he came down from Sydney to join the rehearsals because he was more of a free spirit of the band, couldn't stand the routine of rehearsing and getting things tight. He just wanted to show up and be the lead singer. So fair enough, we're all working on stuff and whatever. They throw this new song out there called Night Owls. And, hey, he's not here. Why don't you sing it until he shows up? That was the story I was told. Great, so we're singing it, and it, you know, fits me down to a T, and it was in my range and all this other kind of stuff. And so Glenn shows up a couple days before we're going to get the stage in New Zealand, and he's trying to catch up to what we've already rehearsed. So we ended up splitting verses. I sang one, he sang one, and it just became very evident that it was more suited to my voice than it was to his and whatever. Well, it turns out that that was all planned. That was all a script that writer was playing out because he was not satisfied with the way the lead singer was interpreting his songs. He didn't like the arguments. He didn't like the grief. He was auditioning me in America to be the guy that sang his songs because he didn't like the way the lead singer was doing it. And I was completely unaware of this and oblivious to it until about literally 4 or 5 years later, after the lead singer had left, I find out that this was actually the story of what was going on. That was only the tip of the iceberg of all the political maneuverings that were going on with the band. But that's the essence of the story of Night Owls and the whole, you know, progression of it was that song was basically written about, you know, some American guy that stayed out late at night and, you know, toured the streets and so on and so forth. And was it me? No, probably not. But it was certainly meant for me to sing.
The follow-up to the hit single Night Owls was a great tune called Take It Easy on Me. Was that experience like for you personally, being in the studio, recording with the guys, and recording that first album with the band? What was that experience like for you?
Well, it was surreal to have been chosen to be the person to jump into that role. You know, my first show was in front of 130,000 people in Munich. You know, then the tours of the continuing tours of Europe and America and so on and so forth. And then came time, okay, we've got this material. We're ready to go. We need to choose a producer. And who shows up at one of our shows in Atlanta, Georgia, but George Martin.
Wow.
And the night before had been Tom Dowd. So two legendary producers from our time had come to see the band. All of us were, of course, Beatles fans and respectful of that history. So it was one guy picked Tom Dowd, and I can't blame him. You can't go wrong. But George Martin was just kind of almost a unanimous choice for this is a good match for the vocals and for the textures of what LRB does. Let's go with George. So we go to his island, or not his island, but his studio on Montserrat. And we're in this bubble of Beatles history and this beautiful studio with the best gear. And Jeff Emmerich is there, who was the Beatles engineer. I can only say it was surreal. George was funny. He made rules. He said, look, you can't talk about the Beatles until dinner time. And the dinner bell rings. All questions about the Beatles are on the table. I'll tell you anything I know. And then when dessert and coffee comes, the Beatles questions are done. We go back to work. So we had that kind of layout for the day and this beautiful setting. We were there for 6 weeks. But Take It Easy on Me is, there's an inside story to that one, too. We were treating Take It Easy on Me as basically kind of an album track. It was, we count to four, we play it, we end. And it was not really being looked at as, dare I say, that important of a song. And I just believed in the whole thing. I believed in the story, the power of the verse, the power of the chorus. I felt it had more to give than what we were doing. But again, with all that politics flying around in the room, nobody was willing to stand up and say, let's fine-tune this thing. Let's make this into a great record as opposed to just a track that's on the record. We're cutting the tracks, and I finally said, and this was my first contribution as the new guy in terms of arrangements and writing and whatever, because I was new to the whole process. And I said, look, how about this thing starts piano and vocal, builds a little bit to the first chorus, and then bang, the verse is in, the whole band's into the second verse, and we take it out full strength. And we did it once that way, even in its rough form. And to hear George Martin come on the talkback and say, great idea, that's how we're cutting the song, let's go.
And how was the great single, The Other Guy, discovered, Wayne? How was that song come about?
Okay, so the politics finally came to play. Time Exposure is, you know, about to run its course. And in early 1982, Storick says, look, lead singers, politics, blah, 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 all of this stuff, I need a break. I want to do my own album. And everybody in the band, although I was new, I had a vote. I voted against it. But everybody else was, no, we're doing the next record. We are gung-ho to keep riding the wave that we've got. And it's time for us to part company. So, you know, the quote-unquote founding members of the band fired Glenn Short. They fired the lead singer of the band in early 82. The guy that came in to replace him was a guy named John Farnham.
Mm-hmm.
Great singer, an amazing talent, politically and whatever, and at the timing of being new in the band, whatever, I put my hand up. I said, this is crazy. This is stupid. We've just had 6 years in a row of a top 10 single. We broke a Billboard record. And if you think about it, Michael Jackson, Beatles, Stones, Who, Guess Who, Fleetwood Mac, wait a minute, we are the first band to ever have 6 top 10 years in a row? That's incredible.
Right.
Why are we firing the lead singer and songwriter of 2 of those hits, 3 of those hits, by the way, why are we firing the lead singer? Well, because it's, you know, artistic differences or whatever. I said, you guys have got your head up your Australian backsides, excuse my expression. I voted against it, but I was outvoted, whatever. So this guy comes in named John Farnham, who is hands down one of the best singers in the world. Incredible talent. So on we go. You know, the next song out of Graham Gobel was the other guy. And we recorded it and released it on the Greatest Hits CD as basically, here's John's first vehicle for American radio, so on and so forth. And I mean, there is a backstory to the other guy. There was actually an other guy that Graham wrote about. And I'm not going to go any further and name any names or tell the story, but there really was a guy that was the other guy that he was worried about with his wife.
Gotcha.
So story.
Gotcha.
Delivered the song to John, and it was his first vehicle in the U.S. And there you go. It went to number 11. We almost got to 7 years in a row with another top 10 hit, but it peaked out at 11. So
right.
Broke the string.
Wait, tell me about the new single "Lost" and "The Lonely," and what else are you guys currently working on?
Well, the new CD is just out now. After almost a year and a half of negotiation, song selection, recording while we were on tour, mixing, getting everything approved, and then looking for a release date, we've been working on this CD, which is called Cuts Like a Diamond, for about 18 months. So, first of all, what's on the horizon is doing everything we can to let people know around the world that not only are we alive and well, but we've got a great, great new CD. The Lost and the Lonely was a song that came from Outside Writers. There is no denying, as soon as you hear that chorus, and as soon as I heard the chorus done a cappella, that's a Little River Band chorus. That's a Little River Band statement. I knew that much.
Very cool, Wayne. Very, very cool. I always loved the Little River Band. Grew up on you guys here in Southern California. Kayla West played you guys all the time, and just loved the band. For more information on Wayne Nielsen and the Little River Band, just go to littleriverband.com. Lead singer Wayne Nielsen of the Little River Band, thank you so very much. I really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. I'm going to blow smoke here for a minute.
Sure.
JJ, what you guys are doing, you know, people with a presence on the internet and then, you know, FM, you know, people, independent thought. In my mind, corporate radio playing 17 songs a day, come on. That's not what radio and music were about. And what you guys are doing, it might not happen today, it might not happen tomorrow, but you're the core of making sure that other music gets heard. There's so much good music being done out there by people that is not Justin Bieber and Taylor Swift. And no offense to them, because God bless them, they're doing what they do at the time that they're doing it, but you're keeping the rest of it alive. And I you know, all the good luck and best wishes I can send your way, because we're very grateful you're there.
Thank you, Wayne. You just gave me chills here in the studio, and the AC's not even on.
You don't need it out there. I am dead serious. I mean it. I'm talking to more and more people who are starting to come out of the shadow of the corporatization of radio. And, you know, whenever it happens and however long it takes to build that wave back up, you guys are doing a great service for all the people that listen to a wide variety of music, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Wayne. You know what? I started here on this fair. KSBR has been on the air here in Southern California for 30 years, and I started here when I was in high school, which was a long time ago, and I did the corporate radio scene, and then I came back here because, you know, our program director believes in the talent that he has here on his on-air staff, and he basically lets us play whatever we want to play.
Well, that's great. I'm starting to run into people, and I got to tell you, I didn't realize they were there, but I'm running into people all over the country, small pockets of people who are coming up and going, we're playing this, and I'm going, well, how can you do this? How can you choose that? And just what you said, they have an owner or a team of owners who believe in listening to new stuff, taking the effort to listen to new stuff, and not let consultants tell you what you need to program.
Right.
you know, for the next 9 weeks. It is absolutely a breath of fresh air, and I'm reprogramming my radio every time I come somewhere. I'm putting in the new numbers of people like you and other people around the country. It is truly refreshing, and you're going to save, in your own way, you're going to save a part of the music business that needs to be heard.
Absolutely, Wayne. Thank you so very much for your time tonight, sir. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure. Great to talk to you, and if we get to L.A., please, or anywhere in the West Coast, come say hello.